Buenos días a todas y todos, bienvenidas y bienvenidos. Voy a presentar la charla magistral del profesor Amit Bhaduri. Voy a hacer la presentación en español, mejor dicho, en mi español, que no es exactamente el español. Y sin embargo, la clase es, el profesor la va a dictar en inglés. Bueno, primero que todo, quiero agradecer al profesor Bhaduri que aceptó nuestra invitación a Flaxo, una invitación para dictar un curso del que beneficiaron los estudiantes de la maestría y del doctorado en Economía del Desarrollo, y también para dar esta charla magistral. Quiero introducir la charla intentando dibujar rápidamente para no, digamos, no robarle espacio al profesor, intentando dibujar rápidamente, digamos, el perfil intelectual de Amit Bhaduri y sus importantes contribuciones al conocimiento social y macroeconómico en particular. Ustedes saben, eso es importante decirlo, que el profesor Amit Bhaduri acaba de ganarse el premio Leontief por la economía. El premio Leontief es un premio muy importante. Normalmente se le reconoce, digámoslo así, vulgarizando un poco, el premio Leontief es el premio Nobel de los economistas heterodoxos, para entender un poco el punto. No siempre es el premio Nobel de los economistas heterodoxos, ya que, para darle un ejemplo, en 2014 el premio Leontief se lo ganó el profesor August Ditton, que el año siguiente se ganó el premio Nobel. Entonces estamos hablando de un premio importante y por eso es un grande honor tener aquí con nosotros el profesor Amit Bhaduri. Bueno, rápidamente, las contribuciones intelectuales más importantes del profesor, para que tengan una idea de su perfil, intelectual. Yo creo que hay por lo menos cuatro campos del conocimiento macroeconómico en los que el profesor contribuido con importantes trabajos. Tal vez el más conocido es el campo de estudio sobre las economías así llamadas wage-led o profit-led, digamos, economías trainadas por los salarios o economías trainadas por las ganancias. El trabajo fundamental, el que se dice un seminal paper, fue publicado en el Cambridge Journal of Economics en el 1990. Es un trabajo que el profesor realizó juntos a Stephen Marglin. Y, digamos, se trata de una contribución importante para entender la relación entre distribución del ingreso y crecimiento económico. ¿Cuándo, a cuáles condiciones una distribución más egalitaria del ingreso puede empujar el crecimiento económico, y al contrario, cuándo y a cuáles condiciones una distribución menos egalitaria del ingreso puede empujar el crecimiento económico? A partir de este estudio seminal del 1990 se han desarrollado muchísimos, una cantidad impresionante de estudios empíricos para determinar si esta economía o otras economías son economías wage-led o profit-led. Digamos, en este sentido ha sido verdaderamente un paper seminal que ha originado una grandísima cantidad de estudios empíricos. Otra contribución importante del profesor es una contribución anterior, creo en 1973, si no me estoy equivocando. El profesor acababa, digamos, de recibir su PhD en la Universidad de Cambridge, Inglaterra. Y es una contribución sobre la naturaleza del cambiamiento tecnológico, de los avances tecnológicos. Se trata de un libro sobre las razones por las cuales en muchos lugares del mundo se aplican las mismas técnicas productivas desde siglos. Es un problema súper interesante. ¿Por qué hay regiones de la India, por ejemplo, donde desde siglos, a pesar del hecho de que en India, como todos sabemos, hayan buenísimos ingenieros, buenísimos tecnólogos, etcétera, por qué a pesar de eso se aplican las mismas técnicas productivas por siglos? Y el trabajo, que es un trabajo teórico y empírico del profesor, nos muestra las razones sociales de la falta de avance tecnológico. Básicamente la idea, la gran contribución es mostrar que el avance tecnológico no es un problema tecnológico, es un problema social. Y esto es la segunda gran contribución del profesor. Una tercera contribución, por lo menos en mi interpretación, yo he tenido la chance, digamos, de conocer al profesor desde hace mucho tiempo, y entonces lo que le estoy diciendo se relaciona no solamente con la lectura de sus textos, sino también con las charlas. Una tercera contribución importante se relaciona, digamos, a su forma de trabajar la economía keynesiana. Amit Badouri recibió su PhD en Cambridge en el 1967 con John Robinson. John Robinson era un grande estudiante de John Maynard Keynes, entonces esto es un poco el perfil intelectual. Y digamos, en sus textos, en sus libros, Badouri siempre ha intentado explicar Keynes a partir de Marx. Esta es otra contribución muy importante, digamos. El misterio de la demanda efectiva, de la demanda agregada, digamos, explicado utilizando Marx y en particular los esquemas de reproducción, creo que se diga así en español, ¿no? Los esquemas de reproducción de Karl Marx utilizados para explicar Keynes. Una cuarta contribución, hay muchas, yo me limito a cuatro, digamos, para darles las ideas fundamentales sobre el perfil intelectual de Amit Badouri. Una cuarta contribución es la más reciente, yo diría es corriente. Hemos tenido un par de clases muy buenas durante el curso que el profesor acaba de dictar acá en Flaxo sobre este asunto, y el asunto es la naturaleza de la finanza moderna. O sea, la vieja finanza, la finanza tradicional, la conocemos todos, son los bancos, los bonos públicos, etcétera, etcétera. La finanza moderna es la finanza de los así llamados herramientas financieras complejas, los derivados, las options, etcétera, etcétera, que se encuentran, digamos, a la origen de la grande crisis del 2007-2008. Entonces, frente a eso, frente a una crisis de tamaño parecido a la grande crisis del 1929, el profesor ha intentado y está intentando, digamos, darle una racionalización a este mundo tan complejo de la finanza moderna. Un mundo tan complejo que unos productos se llaman productos exóticos, así los llaman en el mundo de la finanza, ¿no? Entonces, intentar de darle, digamos, primero que todo, una racionalización teórica. Esto es la grande contribución de Badouri. Es muy importante, digamos, para ayudarnos a no ser tan perdidos frente a esos choques durísimos que han golpeado la economía mundial. Hoy, en esta clase magistral, el profesor nos va a hablar de los temas que yo acabo de ilustrar y que constituyen, digamos, su perfil intelectual. El profesor va a hablar de la relación entre teoría económica y poder. el título de la clase es el mismo de la clase que dio hace unas semanas cuando le entregaron el premio Leontief. Sin embargo, el profesor me ha recomendado de explicar que la clase va a ser muy distinta, ni siquiera tan parecida a la clase que dio en ocasión del otorgamiento del premio Leontief. La relación entre teoría económica y poder es, digamos, es compleja. Sí, mejor dicho, la relación entre economía y poder es compleja. Y la teoría económica dominante, por lo menos la teoría económica dominante, sin lugar a duda no ha sabido incorporar en sus aparatos analíticos esa complejidad. La teoría económica dominante es una teoría sin poder. Entonces, es una gravísima falta de la teoría económica dominante, y estoy seguro que va a ser muy interesante escuchar la reflexión de Amit Bhaduri sobre este punto. Termino otra vez agradeciendo muchísimo al profesor para aceptar la invitación, agradecer también a Flaxo, que digamos me apoyó en esta iniciativa personal, entonces muchas gracias también a Flaxo. Y otra vez, digamos, quiero reiterar el honor y el placer de estar con un grandísimo intelectual y un amigo muy, muy sincero. Les agradezco mucho, y ahora vamos a pasar a la clase y al inglés. We can start. I don't know whether you understand. Okay, fine.
Somewhat.
Okay.
60%.
60%, it's okay.
I speak from here or there. It's better here.
Es mejor hablar desde aquí o desde allá. As you like.
Okay, it's all right. Since well, thank you very much, Marco Misalia, an old friend of mine. So even though it was a very generous introduction of my work, don't take it too seriously. I'm really not that great an economist. Well, in so far as today's thing is concerned, I think I should start by saying that, you know, after I came to Flasco, I began to realize that one of its most important characteristic is its interdisciplinary character, that so many social sciences are represented here. And the topic on which I'm going to speak today is also a topic which cuts across artificial academic disciplines. After all, academic disciplines like you call sociology, anthropology, economics, political science, they are created for us to be professors. When you have real life problems, they are problems which do not go by this kind of artificial academic boundaries. Nor does the question of power. The question of power appears in all social sciences, but in different forms. If you are doing sociology or anthropology, you will see the sanction of power, the power exercised by sanction in blood relations, power exercised by religion, power exercised by various other forms of social customs. In politics, it's too obvious for me to talk. And in so far as economics is concerned, power is exercised through, very largely through the market. And at least that's a good starting point of how to analyze power. When I started thinking about power in general, not only for this lecture or the earlier lecture in connection with Leontief Prize, when I started thinking about power, I was looking for, because power is something which you cannot statistically measure, which you cannot say, well, this is power. You can measure inequality, you can measure wealth distribution, if you have statistics, you can measure income distribution, but power is invisible. And the most natural analogy of power is the law of gravity. This is the conclusion I came to, because like gravity It is the organizing principle of society. It is the organizing principle of the economy. And yet, precisely like gravity, it cannot be directly observed. It has to be observed through various other things like inequality, decisions made by the government, by the more powerful against the less powerful, and so on. This is the first thing about power. The second point of this analogy is that exactly like gravity, it's not a one-body problem. You cannot describe power only if you have one person. You can describe power if you have more than one person, two or many. Similarly, with gravity, you cannot call the force of attraction, the organizing principle, just on itself. You require at least two bodies. And this is really the starting point of understanding what is not, what is false in the analysis of power. Because you mentioned Nobel Prizes and so on, let me start with one famous Chicago economist who got a Nobel Prize. And what's his name? I'm getting old.
Milton Friedman.
No. The first one. Let me start with his case. Gary Becker. I just forgot the name. Gary Becker, who got a Nobel Prize some time ago, and lots of people work on this. You see, Gary Becker tried to describe, and I had once met him many years ago, and he was writing about race relations, relations among races. And he said, and he published papers which said that race relations are basically nothing but preferences of individuals. This is actually methodological individualism in theory. That is, you think of one rational individual and you think that you can derive the theory from him. Now, this Gary Becker's theory was said that, you know, to put it simply, if, in his example, if I do not want to have a black neighbor, that is because, you know, it is my preference. I prefer to have people who are of similar cultures, so on and so forth. And my black neighbor is welcome to have exactly the same thing, that he may not like to have a white neighbor. The reason why Becker is wrong is, and that kind of analysis is wrong, methodological individualism in analyzing power, is that as soon as you see very quickly, it is not reciprocal. That is, a white neighbor not wanting to have a black neighbor is not quite the same as a black neighbor saying that I want to move into a slightly cleaner neighborhood in the United States. And this lack of reciprocity is one of the aspects which makes it power, which makes it institutions and power. This notion of power gets very complicated unless you think about it. If you think of very many social relations, economic relations, social relations, I will give you only one example and that will make it very clear. It is from a famous economist who was also a colleague of mine in Cambridge, England, who migrated from Harvard, from America to Cambridge, England, and we were in the same college in Cambridge, Richard Goodwin. Goodwin gave the example following a friend, one of his friends' advice, was a biologist. He said that, you see, if you think of capitalism, after all, it's a mutual dependence. I mean, capital cannot exist without labor, labor cannot exist without capital. Fine, so why do you say it is power? I mean, there is a mutual dependence. The example comes from biology, and the mathematics comes from mathematical biology, where actually you have something like rabbits and tigers. If the tigers are not there, the number of rabbits can grow to a very large number almost without limit within a region. The tigers eat the rabbits and keep them in number, keep the number controllable. If the number of, if the tigers become too many and eat too many rabbits, then actually the tiger population itself would die out. And think of the rabbit as workers, think of the tigers as capitalists, and you will see immediately this analogy. And this is something which is very famous in nonlinear dynamics, in Lotka-Volterra system, where actually it is observed that big fish and small fish are in a cycle. If the big small fishes are too many of them are eaten up, big fishes themselves begin to die out. If there are too many small fishes on the other hand, there will be a problem for the big fishes to survive. So it actually in Adriatic Sea and so on, you have the cycle, and it was Lotka who was a biologist and Volterra who was a mathematician. They together made one of the most famous problems of mathematical biology. Now this is a very similar notion of slave and master, of any two mutually dependent people, worker and capitalist, colonizer and the colonized. Everywhere there is a mutual dependence. And the mutual dependence, the more you read history, it looks like mutual dependence. The whole problem of analyzing power, it is like in a chemical reaction, to find the main principle by which there is a mutual dependence, but the mutual dependence is shot through, is intermingled with domination. And this is what I want to explain clearly. That if you do not, if you leave out the Gary Becker kind of methodological individualism, that you take one individual in isolation and you can describe his taste, and there is nothing called power and so on. If you leave out that kind of absurdity, or that kind of extreme, almost fanatic liberalism, then actually you come to the next stage in subjects like economics of how to capture power. And the way it is done, and this is the dominant way in which almost all major American, British, I mean the languages which I know reasonably well, German, where it is taught, is to say that, well, you know, the society, the market is a collection of individuals who have their income, and they are collected by, connected by their income and their prices. Okay? And they'll be connected by their prices and income, and there is no other, and this is the nature of market interaction. This is not quite Adam Smith, from whom they quote, because Adam Smith also had many other sentiments involved in the, you know, creation of the market. But anyway, this is the form in which modern Anglo-Saxon economics, at least, and its influences in almost all over Europe, takes it as given. Now, if you go through this theory is highly mathematical. It is known as general equilibrium theory and so on, and it's extremely important to demystify it. I spent years in my youth understanding the mathematics and the economics, and then realized it was simply not worth it. And this is worth saying, why is it the case? Because this general equilibrium theory actually originally started by a French mathematician engineer, Walras. It basically says that, you know, if you think of the market and you think of somebody whom he calls the auctioneer, somebody who calls out the price, and at that price, people exchange goods, but people are not allowed to exchange the goods until the correct price is reached, the price at which demand and supply are equal. Okay? The price at which the people who are wanting to sell at that price equals the number of people who are trying to, amount of commodity they're trying to buy the goods at that price. Now, and outside, until that price is reached, you are not allowed to trade because of technical reasons, out of equilibrium, income effect is not allowed and so on, but these are unimportant. This is very much like the French philosopher, writer, Voltaire's invented God. There is no auctioneer in the actual market system, but you have to invent an auctioneer to rule out what? If you think, and this is what a typical economist will not tell you. You can go through an economics PhD in Harvard, MIT, wherever it is, and they will never tell you why. Simply because when you, an auctioneer is needed, will set the price, a mystical, like an invented god. An auctioneer will set the price because at that price, you will, all the market will clear. But nobody has the power to set the price. It's somehow the equilibrium price is set. And even today, economics has not got out of it. This, in economics jargon, is called, you do not have a price setter. Everybody is a price taker. It is like we go to the market and we take the price of whatever it is. We take the price of Apple to be 10. But we have no way of changing the price. And the whole theory of general equilibrium is needed to say that nobody sets the price in a market. It's really trying to invent a grand mathematical theory and some 4 Nobel Prizes to simply to say that you can imagine a market where there is no power. It sounds, if you have not done economics or if you have not done this kind of economics, it might sound a bit fantastic. But this is what much of the subject is, the emperor without clothes. Now, when very soon people started seeing that this is not true, this simply does not happen. Somebody sets the price, there has to be a monopolist, there has to be a duopolist, there has to be oligopolist. There are a few people who get together or separately compete with one another to set prices. Then the next defense came in terms of saying, and this is the main thing on which I want to, from which I want to go to the subject, to the real politics of it in a minute. The main defense came by saying, yes, you know, this is true, but actually people brought up in the tradition, there is a big mistake. We could not introduce anybody who has the power to set prices. Now I will tell you how to do it. Power is set because, precisely because, some people have more information, some people have less information. And by having more information, you can decide to set the price. There are, you know, it's called asymmetric information, it is called various other names, moral hazard, so on and so forth. Now this becomes, having more information and less information, let me just take this out, the essence of the problem. Suppose there are two individuals, A and B. A wants to follow course of action 1, B wants to follow course of action 2. Now, if A has more information, suppose A is a doctor. A tells B, if you are smoking, this is the course of action you follow, but this is very bad because there is a high chance you will get cancer, etc., etc. And you give the information, you stop him from the course of action of smoking, action B. Okay, this sounds all right. You can also do the opposite. You can give misinformation. And in this age of, you know, advertisement and television and media, this is probably far more important than giving information. You can also give the opposite information, and every politician in power knows it better than me, that you can give the kind of information by which you misinform people to say, well, in the crudest form, you vote for me. In the less crude form, that this is the way in which the country will grow, in which the growth will be higher, this, that, and so on. You can misinform people and thereby persuade the public. So information is a very important strategic variable in modern system. So by information and misinformation, you do influence people's set of action and their choices, and stop them from doing something, make them do something. This is certainly true. But it forgets probably the most important part, which is a part of modern democracy. And this is the part I want to come in, and I want to explain with 2 examples, very short examples. 1 example from the United States and modern finance, and another example from India, the country I come from and I live in. If you take the case of you know, the, apart from giving just information, there is a third way in which you can stop people from doing what they want to do. That is, you dominate their choice by stopping them from doing something which they want to do. And that is simply by closing the option. Not by brute force, but you can close the option by what you call today. And this is really what social scientists still now have not, to my knowledge, have not fully understood, or, but this should be one of the biggest areas of research, both by ideology and institutions. You know, institutions in standard theory and so on is a kind of routine. If you have routine action, an institution is a way of routinizing that action for the society. So that you know if you go to a bank, you will get the money. You know you have to write a check, you will get the money. If you go to a police and make an FIR, you know a certain case will be booked against. These are routine things. But rather than this kind of routinization of action, there is something much deeper about institutions and about ideology, which actually close people's options. First, let me give you just an example from economics about ideology and how it comes in. Market, about which I was talking. You take Adam Smith. Adam Smith's idea of market, apart from the moral sentiments and so on, says that you know the market is the best coordinator for a certain kind of division of labor. And since a modern society needs division of labor, we need a market which will be the best way of coordinating the division of labor. Fine. Look at another great economist, Marx. He says market is exactly the institution by which labor, free from slavery, from serfdom and so on, is forced to sell its labor for a surplus which creates profit. I mean, I'm of course simplifying both Smith and Marx, but the point is clear. Now, one shows the importance of the market for division of labor. One shows the importance of the market for creating surplus and profit. Both are ideologies. Both are ideologies which are grounded in logic. The problem with biased economic theory, any kind of bias, biased economic theory, is to say one is an ideology, the other is not. You know, whichever side you belong to. I think, you know, the real beginning of understanding is when you see that there is an ideological element, but the ideological element is meant to interpret an actual situation of a market, an actual institution of a market. And all institutions combine this ideology and institution. And since I do not have time, I'll just explain this with two examples. Because I gave a similar lecture, as Marco mentioned, on the occasion of the Leontief Prize. I took that advantage to speak it to an American audience, academic audience, because it gave me great pleasure to tell them. Because we are always told that what we should do. So it gave me great pleasure to tell them what was, you know, going on there. Now, in the first example, if you think of the American financial crisis of 2007-08, you have a very, very simple case which you can think of. You see, there was one kind of institutions which were created, I would not come to it. It started from 1973-74, when the dollar ceased to be the only international currency, and there was liberalization of capital accounts and so on. The financial markets became much freer and so on. And as a result, but by about 2000-2002-03, in the United States, a strange animal began to appear in the financial market. And the animal is not securitization, derivatives and so on, they are the product. It is generally called, even in the president's report in the United States, it was called in 2007-08, the shadow banking system. Now the shadow banking system, the crux of it, if you have to say it in one sentence, the crux of it is very simple. The banking system has a supervisor, which is the central bank, the Federal Reserve System, so on and so forth. And if a bank fails, if the depositors cannot be paid back the money, then it is the responsibility of the Federal Reserve System to help the banks as a lender, to lend them money, etc., etc., so that the bank does not fail. But in exchange, what the banks can do, how much credit they can create, against what they can create credit, etc., is supervised by the central bank. So on the one hand, you have the regulation of the central bank, and on the other hand, you have the guarantee of the central bank. The strange animal of the, what do you call it, the shadow banking system which appeared, was neither strictly in law regulated by the Federal Reserve System of the central bank. Opposite wise, it was not controlled how much credit it can create. So the credit it can create, and you know, credit is not the dollar note which I have in my pocket. The credit is, if I can convince you that, you know, I will, in case you require the money, I will be able to give it to you. You trust me, and that is my credit to you, and you can give similar credit to me. And the whole shadow bank system was based on this mutual trust of credit. Trust is not always a social capital, and this was very clearly proved by the financial market in the United States. That among the banker, you know, among the shadow bankers, trust can be a dangerous thing for the rest of the society. But anyway, shadow banking was, to come back to the main theme, shadow banking was the institution, and it was, because it was not regulated by the central bank, a new ideology was made common. And what is that ideology? Self-regulation. Banks know their self-interest, they will not go burst, they will not go kaput, so therefore banks will self-regulate themselves. They will know how to regulate themselves. You see a very clear example of what I was saying. Institution is shadow banking, unregulated banking, unregulated finance, and the ideology is self-regulation. It was promoted by, you know, not only by the central bankers and the politicians and so on, but it was also promoted by very many economists in all the respectable American universities at that time. As a matter of fact, I had great difficulty when I went at that time to lecture, to even to, you know, have a sort of rational conversation, because everybody was so full of self-regulation of banks that it was, I mean, it is a bit unbelievable today. There's a second example which is happening right now. Right now, I mean, in 2016, March, April. This is, and you will see its effect very soon, and this is to stop people from taking a course of action. Say, for example, a bank has overlent and you want to control it. You want to say that, you know, if the bank now cannot pay back, usually the government says, any government, left, right, the label doesn't matter, any government says that, well, we cannot let a bank fail. Okay, if it has overlent, so we have to give it money, like they did in America in 2008, and many countries they did it in Europe and so on. But except for one country in Europe, a small country, Iceland, which nobody talks about, nowhere else when you give the money, normally what do? Against the money you get something. You get a guarantee. And what is the guarantee? The least you can expect is some shares of the bank, or the shares of the, you know, the equities of the bank. This is not done. Why? Because this would go against banks' self-regulation. And at the same time, it is said that unless you save the bank, economists call it moral hazard, unless you save the bank, it's dangerous. The whole financial system would collapse. Probably a big part would collapse. So you have to save the bank, but you cannot control it. And this is the ideology which is today, which is most of the Mediterranean countries are suffering from it. You have to give the banks have overlent, the banks have overborrowed from German banks and so on. But at the same time, there is a constant thing that you have to give it, but don't, at the same time, don't take over the control. Don't do what Iceland did. That's the only country which actually did not ignore the thing and is doing much better than most others. My second example is not, this is the connection between institution and ideology and how it actually closes your choice. So that if you are an individual, you are, you know, wanting to build a house or you know, move into a new house or whatever it is, get your first house, you have no choice but to go to a mortgage bank in the United States, negotiate, refinance loan, etc., etc. But basically, it is that institution which will decide and that ideology which will go, whether you believe in it or not, that it is self-regulated mortgage bank which will be your future house. Okay? And this is where the subprime crisis took place. Now let me go to the example which is closer home and on which I work. That is the Indian example. And I hope this will not be the true in Ecuador. I don't know much about the country. But this is something which is very generally true, and of the two biggest, most populous in terms of number of people, both India and China, with very different political systems. But I'll stick to India because it's closer. But I have enough Chinese friends also to know what's going on there. In the Indian case, it's very simple. You see, suddenly from the time liberalization started, 1990-91, the government said that development is nothing but higher growth. You have higher growth and the poor will be taken care of, either because their income will also grow or because you will have, through taxes and so on, you will always have the capacity to pay for the poor, to save the poor from being very miserable. This was said in parliaments and so on, but basically the government equated the idea of development with the idea of economic growth, GDP growth. Okay? I'm here not talking about environment, I'm here not talking about the problems, there are deep problems here, but I'll simply talk about how the ideology is mixed with the institution and how this... You see, when they wanted to have higher growth in a poor country like India, how do you assure that this growth will take place? Who will bring about the growth? The state is not going to do it because it was already decided that the state cannot do it, inefficient, etc., etc. So it will be the large private corporations. In China, it is the large corporations, partly state-owned. In India, it is the large corporations, entirely private. Now, they have to be given the incentive for higher growth, invest for higher growth. It's a country with poor infrastructure. It's a country with a lot of poor people, with poor educational system, poor health system for the poor. You know, there are lots and lots of problems in this huge country. So how do you suddenly motivate the investors? Government found a way. They never said it openly, but found a way. According to the existing laws set up by the British colonial period and more or less handed over in the... You can take land for public purpose. Probably it is similar in this country also. You can acquire land saying that, you know, I have to build a railroad here, I have to dig for oil here, I have to do, you know, mineral resources, so on and so forth. So if it is a public purpose, you take land from the poor, from the peasants. You take the land, and the new clause which the government introduced is that the government will take it for a public purpose, but may use private parties to do the job. Public-private partnership or pure private companies can be then given the land to do the job. Fine? So, India on an average, since for the last 30 years I calculated, no official statistics exist, I spent almost a year putting the statistics together, you get anything close to 1 million people who are displaced from the villages, from their traditional livelihood destroyed, to say that this land is needed for industrialization, for higher growth. Okay. You take the land and then you give it to the big corporations. Almost cheap, almost free in many cases, along with the water, along with the electricity, so on and so forth, road connections and so on. You give it to them. Now, if these people invested, then it would have been a different kind of problem. It would have been a problem of the Soviet Union, where it was not the private sector, but the government was going. And you saw the consequences of this for environment and so on. But in India, something very strange happens. Once the corporations, after they are not there for the benefit of the humanity, they are there for their profit. So when they see that this land is a much easier way of making much greater profit than manufacturing, much of their energy goes into lobbying for land with the government, land and natural resources with the government. I say this because every country which has natural resources as its main source of economic development faces this problem. I make this prediction, and you remember this in this country also. So the government says this, government gives the land, the corporations realize that this is a grand way of quickly getting rich. If you look at the world chart of the richest people, the list, America comes one, China comes two, Russia until recently, now it has downgraded a little bit, come to five, used to be three, India used to be four. It has nothing to do with, and Japan is quite high, Italy is nowhere. This is, despite Mr. Berlusconi, by the way, this ranking, the interesting thing about this ranking is that in Russia, you can almost say 1-to-1. Most of the billionaires, the very, very rich people of the world, were created during privatization. Both in India and in China through party connections, in India through not so open connections, but these people are people who have got access to natural resources of various sorts. I mean, in India, out of the 52, I did not even recognize when I did this detective work, 36 of them. Their names are because even in the last few years, through some political connections or God knows what, they have got the, coal mines, they have got the diamond mines, they have got this, that, and they are the richest wealth earners by world standards, dollar multi-billionaires. Now, this you create in the name, the ideology here, to go back to the, you use the state power to promote the ideology that growth is development. Forget about everything else. Growth is development. Forget about inequality and so on. You just try to grow faster. For this, you need natural resources and land. This you give to the people who will bring about the growth, namely the corporations. The corporations get the land. And I come to the last part of the story at the end. When the corporations get this land and this wealth free and become enormously rich, like they have never been before, what do? They give money back to political parties so that these policies continue. First, it continues with the government in power, the political party in power, or the coalition in power. Very soon, in the competitive game of multi-party democracy, what do? All other political parties feel they are disadvantaged unless they have money to fight elections, enough money to fight elections. Costs of election go up enormously. It's unimaginable even for people like me to fight elections. Maybe one or two individuals can win, but generally it is not, the system does not allow ordinary citizens to fight elections. What in economics you call price out. You raise the price of fighting elections so high, entering the electoral race so high, ordinary individuals are out of the race. Corporations have given the money to the government. The government actually starts twisting policies. Corruption is not so much an individual corruption. You twist policies, like you say that land will be given to this corporation, to that corporation, for this, for that, and you twist the policies in the process. The unfortunate thing is, India at one level is a large functioning democracy. Every 5 years, governments come and go, and in its 60 years of history, except for 2 years, there has never been a question of a, military dictatorship or anything else. So in a sense, in the usual sense, in the textbook sense, it's probably the world's largest democracy in terms of number of people. But if you look closely into it, what is increasingly happening, and particularly since the last 20, 25, 30 years, And now it is much more apparent. The corporations are giving money, the government, the all political parties, from the extreme fundamentalist right party, which is a religious party of the extreme right, nationalist, Hindu nationalist party, to the extreme left, which is called the communist parties of various sorts, they all take money because they all have to fight elections. And to fight elections, they need and they collect money to various sorts. We have a Right to Information Act by which you are supposed to give the information. All political parties are against it. So we fought for it, but we have been stopped because the political party says that we don't, you know, we are not subject to this law. Anyway, that's an internal story. So in the process, you twist, you begin by twisting the notion of development to the notion of growth, high GDP growth. Then the high GDP growth is the high GDP growth of the large corporations. And this is the story of China also. Only the democracy part is not quite the same in China. High growth, which has to be done by corporations. Finally, you come to a stage where the corporations decide what would be the largely the nature of the democracy. So from a corporate-led growth, you are moving towards a corporate-led democracy. Last year, I will end by just telling one personal story, which is I had a conversation with the head of the Central Bank of Austria, who was a former student, friend, student of mine and so on. And he had just come back from the European Central Bank. This is not a story about India, this is not a story about America. And I was telling him that what was happening in India about this with a little bit of statistics and so on. And he said, well, you know, I just came back from Frankfurt. And I should tell you that in your country you are telling all this, but you know, in our case, it is the credit rating agencies which are now rating the democracies. That is, if your democracy, if Greek's democracy is good or bad, is rated by whether Greece can pay back the loan, which means it will borrow more loan, and which would be through the credit rating agency. So this is, while I stuck to the example of India and of America, but I think this is a very, very widespread problem. Something, in Hamlet's words, something is wrong with the state of Denmark. That something is wrong with the state of democracy. Thank you.